Hello, welcome to the Harvest Money Show. I am your host, Jackie Achani. In our first episode of the Harvest Money Show, where we ventured into the world of strawberry farming, we visited a very unique farm that was in Entebbe. We visited the farm of one Rebecca Azar. She is a teacher who actually transitioned into the world of strawberry farming, out of curiosity actually. And she started with just six strawberry plants, if I remember so well. There were just six. And today, she has a whole acre of strawberries planted somewhere in her farm. So she was very kind enough to, you know, accept to talk to us, to share her experience of growing strawberries, especially in a small space of land that is in the urban setting. So today we want to see how she transitioned from, you know, just six plants of strawberries into a whole acre of strawberry in a very, you know, urban setting. So for you who is out there in your, you know, in your living room watching this show and wondering what you can do with your small piece of land in your area, this is a show for you, you know, to follow Kinley and see how you can do strawberry farming in your, in your home in an urban setting. So without wasting time, let's get the show started. I'm glad you talk about us. You mentioned a bit of challenges, you know, and how you've addressed them. But I just wanted us to talk generally about the challenges of strawberry farming. I'm saying that the sun is too hot. The strawberries are just there. It's not like they have some coverage to shield the sun. Let's talk about the general challenges of farming when it comes to strawberries.
Number one, strawberries, they're very picky. I wonder when people say they're very easy to grow.
Right.
They're very picky, the soil must be right. Because the roots are thin. So the soil must be worked to be as light as possible so that the roots can move wherever they want to go to look for the feed that is out there that you have put. Because you're not going to just feed here where it is. It has to, the root system has to move relatively well. So you have to work the soil. You have to do soil testing to get to know what your soil conditions are, the soil pH, what is the species, how much nitrogen do you have there, or any other element, how much of it do you have, and therefore, what will you need to add so that this plant thrives? It is very important to do soil testing. It is very important to do, if you're going to add in things like manure, you need to decompose it because it also has some elements that are not right for the berry, the root system. So it is not that you're going to get a strawberry seed and open up some ground and put it there and think that everything is okay. No. You have to make yourself knowledgeable about what it is that you're getting into in strawberries, and you must like it. It's not about Rebecca is doing it. You must like it, and you should be in position to go all the way. Work the soil, test the soil, get a good seedling, prepare the place well where that seedling is going to sit. Give it enough water. Water is number 1, 2, 3, 4, and 100. You cannot do strawberries without water. They have to be fed, and yet they shouldn't sit in the water. As in to sit and rot. They shouldn't. The water should be moving. And then you get a good crop, and then look after a good plant, and then look after it well, and then get from it. That is the journey.
From your explanation, I gather no soil is bad. You only have to test the soil to understand your soil and then see what is missing. And then you add what is missing and you're good
in
to go.
Good proportions.
It can't be, you can't be a miser when it comes to adding things.
You can't be,
you must be generous.
You must be, you can't be a miser and you cannot overdo it. You need to know what you're doing.
Right.
If you have so much nitrogen, then I can only add so little for the purpose of continuity. If you don't have any, if that soil doesn't have any nitrogen at all, then I have to add the nitrogen that's good enough for the plant. So I have to be informed. People, we need to be informed.
Now, I'm looking at this thing here.
Yes.
I want to guess why you put it there.
Yes, please.
Is it to protect these strawberries from getting in contact with the soil?
Mm-hmm.
So that is my first guess. I can't go further. I'll listen from you. I don't want to go further.
Get into contact with the soil. Mm. Not that the soil is bad.
Mm.
No. But it is a fruit which when you harvest, you saw me.
Yes, you picked and just ate, yes.
Why? Because for us, our crop is organic.
Oh, okay.
I can very comfortably eat my strawberry. I can very comfortably pick it and put it on my table at home for everyone to eat at home, knowing what I do with it.
Mm.
So the mulch is not to protect it from the bad soil, but it is to keep the fruit clean. Because once it rains and it splatters, the soil will go on the fruit. And the fruit, if you look at that strawberry, well, it kind of like has a perforated skin. So if you put it in water, this seed will drop off.
Oh, these, they go off, right?
They'll drop off and then you remain with those holes.
Mm.
Which means it will suck in water.
Okay.
Now, if it is dirty, if I didn't put the mulch and it is dirty, it means I'll have to wash it.
Mm.
If I wash it, it will spoil very quickly because it will have soaked in water.
Ah.
So you, the end user, you have to kind of like consume it very
quickly. Yeah.
So that it doesn't spoil. So it means that strawberry spoils very fast.
Okay.
The other thing, the advantages of having this mulch is it reduces the labor, because I have only two guys here. When you look at all this, I have only two people.
And you don't even have to invest in washing. I mean, you harvested and you have to get lots of water to wash and keep it clean for the market.
Someone needs to wash it at their home. So this mulch reduces labor costs.
Okay.
Because all that my guys are doing right now, for example, to maintain the gardens, is to dig between here and take the grass out. Here, there is no weed. And even when it one or two, you know, types of weed come through, I'll just come here and pluck out one.
That's a weed.
Yeah.
It almost looked like the plant.
I just pluck out one and then it will be easy for me. During my scouting, we do scouting, I will see a weed here, like there, and I'll walk towards it and pick it out as I look at other things. So reducing labor costs. Also, this is breathable. It is a breathable UV treated mulch. So it still allows in some water when it rains. Some water will still soak in. So we still benefit from the rain. Still benefit from it. The plants are happy when you have the rain. But again, it keeps the moisture on the inside so that the strawberry always has just enough of the water that it needs. But, and so many other things among, you know, on top of what I have said. So those are some of them. Labor costs, keeping a clean fruit, and stopping the, in case there are any insects in the ground, they don't come out to come and disturb the fruit, because the plant will grow and cover that whole hole. So then you cannot even see here. Those insects can't come out, but they're not even there because we have treated them.
Okay.
And this heat that comes out of the black, this is black, so it means it gets heat inside there.
Oh.
Nothing survives under there.
Oh.
And yet the condition is still good.
Impressive, impressive. So I wanted us to talk about the weeds that are the biggest challenge. I know you don't have, but maybe if I'm to start farming strawberries, what should I be looking out for?
The worst weed. I think you can deal with all other weeds. You can deal with them, because I hear people have chemical grass. We don't spray here. Just do maintenance, manual maintenance. One of the worst weeds is a weed called the water weed. And where do I get it from? I get it from the manure that I get from the animals.
Because
animals eat it. And it has a seed. So that is how I've gotten the water weed here. I imported it here.
Whoa.
But it is very, very, very I don't even know the word to use. Increase my labor cost.
Your fish sells it all.
The water weed, I don't know yet if there is anything I can use to spray that can help me to control this water weed. Probably at the point of when I bring the manure, can I spray it where it is and then decompose it with that? Because that seed is life. Put it here, it just manifests. It's the worst weed, I think. Because when I got some visitors here, some Israeli guys, some guys from the UK, and were like, you have
water weed? I felt sorry for you. Okay.
The rest can be dealt.
Okay. I also, when we walked in, I saw a snail. Is it friendly to the strawberry, or that is also another problem?
Oh my lord. First of all, now I can smell my finger because I've been touching the strawberry, and it is very flavorful. So the smell, this is exactly where it comes here. Especially they come at night, because at night the strawberry puts out a lot of its scent.
Yeah.
Then attracts whoever wants to come in.
Mm-hmm.
And I know this for sure because I had to do it. I had to find out who is eating my strawberries. I leave them and I think it's to write them.
Yes.
In the morning they have a big hole. That was at home.
Mm-hmm.
But who is
eating?
Do we have, are there some, you know, animals like squirrels? That's what I was thinking.
Right.
Then I went at night with a torch and I found the mothers of snakes seated and they endured.
Snakes?
Snails.
Snails, oh.
Snails?
I saw them, they were quite huge, yeah.
Snails and millipedes. So I don't know yet of something that I can use to spray snails for them to die. So we chose to hand pick them, especially since we are organic farmers. So we hand pick them and we used to kill them with a salt solution. But I got a guest in my farm who just told me, please, you know, just give it to me. But we know with the hand picking, you do away with reproduction.
Right.
So after some time, snails, you know, we reduce the number of snails here because we used to hand pick them and put them in soil solution so they'll die with their eggs. But just now we get some random snails that come down, especially because of the rain. But again, we have gotten someone who wants to have them.
Good for you. Now, my other question would be the fencing.
Yes.
Is this bamboo?
Yes.
Why bamboo? Why are you? And is that, what is that plant?
Yeah, those are mulberries.
Oh.
They're still berries. We have mulberries, we have blackberries, we have raspberries, and we shall soon have our blueberries here. So we are in a berry world. We want to try all these berries out and we see what can we really get into to build our desired expansion.
You're planning on expanding? Tell me about it. Because you've told me so many berries, blueberry, mulberry, everything is here.
Blueberry? No, we don't have blueberries.
Oh, not yet.
We have them. I've done some research and I know the one that I think I should be having here, depending on the climate conditions we have here. But we have blackberries. They're also on market already. We brand them.
Oh, from this farm.
From this farm. We have blackberries. We have raspberries. We have mulberries. And then we have our strawberries. We also used to have, what are they called? Gooseberries, which, like, those are our common berries here in Tuntunu.
In Uganda, yes.
In Uganda. But all those are berries, but for us, we are trying out those other varieties I've talked about, including the blueberries, which we shall bring here. And God willing, we shall do all our studies here, and we would like to, you know, to bring as many people here to learn and share the knowledge we have here. Of course, paid for.
Not for free. Can't you do some community, like the CSR, just do something free for a few people?
No. CSR is one of the best things that can ever happen to Kuz Fresh Farm. But that doesn't mean that we shouldn't sell our knowledge.
Okay.
Because we've come a long way buying knowledge. So we do a lot of corporate
social responsibility.
Social responsibility elsewhere. We have, because Fresh Farm is looking after 10 families in this village of old judges whose grandchildren have been dropped, you know, in their homes. So we take care of those families.
Mm.
That is one of our ways of doing it. But we plan that when we go into our expansion, we shall really get into some good and very nice social, you know, corporate social responsibilities.
Mm.
We shall expand in a very remote area, very, very, very remote area.
Yeah, away from the urban setting.
Away from the urban setting.
Mm.
We intend to empower the women and the youth together with the men in that area.
Mm.
So I'm looking forward to the day we shall really, you know, go out and do our responsibility and impact our society way, way more than we're doing now.
Mm.
I can't wait for that.
I pray it happens quite soon. So, but I'm still curious about these other barons, how you have fared with them. I know you say you're already, you know, distributing some, but in what quantities? And how are they responding to our environment here?
The other berries, the blackberries, are doing very well. And the people, my clients and customers, hotels, when you have a good chef, executive chef in a hotel who understands how to deal with these crops, man, you need to go. I have a video of from the farm to the table, the hotel table. These guys just transformed this fruit, and you wouldn't even imagine it's coming from here. So people who understand them really, really take them. They simply don't have enough. Like the blackberries, we don't have enough. Raspberries, we don't have enough. Mulberries, mulberries. Everyone, I know many people have mulberries in their families, in their homes.
They do not know.
But they don't know how to deal with them. You can make jam out of these things and just enjoy it so much. And the little people in the homes, these are the people who want to be involved in such projects. So I don't want to preempt on anything. But these are some of the things you will see at Coos Fresh in the near future. We are going to involve little hands in value addition.
Okay.
Yes, of these berries here. And it's going to be very, very impactful.
You still didn't tell me the advantage of having the bamboo.
The bamboo, why do we have this bamboo here? One, we wanted to shield the garden. We want everyone who walks into here just to know that, oh yeah. Because if you're going to, you know, one, it is to shield the garden from the other side, which is more logistical. Number two, it is beautiful.
Okay.
Like everyone who comes and looks at it is like, wow, this palm is nice. But the greatest reason is that we wanted to shield the garden from the people. And then we put an artificial shield, which was put down by a strong wind. We are in the wind path. I don't know the geography.
But it's understandable. Yeah.
So it put down that artificial shield. To the last one, it all broke. So we use the plant, because when the wind is there, because it will never stop, it only has to blow, create its way, goes, and the plant remains and the shield remains. So we thought that the bamboo would do it, and it actually did it very well.
Actually, you're not very far away from the lake. I think I saw the lake as we are coming through.
Yes.
Okay. And I know the trees you left, that is avocado.
Yes.
Mango.
Yes.
It puts a shade.
we have the avo, jackfruit, we have mangoes, we have apples, we have sugar cane. We are importing in other fruits that can work well with the strawberries, because we have a plan.
It's still a secret. Yes. You can't tell. Okay.
Now, but it can be a good thing.
All right. So how big does this thing get, the strawberry? Does it remain at this size, or it gets bigger?
It can get bigger. It can get to like a little mango.
A little mango.
Because I don't have that. I have the
I saw the one you ate was quite big. So that's why I was curious.
Very small. That is very small. I think it can get about 90 grams. We have ever gotten strawberries up to 90 grams, because we have a punnet. Unfortunately, I don't have it here. It takes 250 grams. We sell our strawberries in a 250 gram pack. which is quarter a kilogram. Mm. But on a good harvest, we have only 12 fruits
in that pack. Wow.
Yes.
That means they get to be quite big so and heavy.
12, mm. and you divide, you get 215, divide mm. 12, that whatever grammage you get, mm. our strawberries can get to that. However, mm. they are not the biggest on the market. Mm-hmm. For example, on the international market. Mm. But on the Ugandan market, we have the biggest berry and the sweetest for that matter mm. because of the way we feed it. And I'm so proud and happy to really take that position. Mm. Yes.
Is it thanks to organic farming?
Yes, please. Thanks to also mm. to management.
Okay.
Yes.
I just wanted you to tell us about the advantage of keeping it organic and not, you know, going all with all these chemicals and stuff to have maybe the best looking berries.
Mm-hmm. Mm. I believe that organic farming is user friendly, mm. is human friendly. Mm. Yes, it doesn't mean that because it's organic, it is not, it shouldn't be, you know, like washed mm. or you just have to, you know, like, you know, organic means that whatever it is that the fruit is feeding on mm. comes from nature. For example, we don't throw our leaf away. Mm. We turn it back into liquid, oh. which we now put back into this.
Oh,
so the strawberry feeds on the strawberry.
I can imagine.
Yes.
So I wanted you to take us there, okay? And you show us the other berries.
Oh, the other berries.
Yeah.
Okay, now we have... Mm.
No fruits yet, just the tree. Oh, okay. The white. Mm.
These are all mulberry.
How many trees?
Do you know? I can't tell you some of them. Because we had mulberries from here up mm. to there.
Mm-hmm. So you cut.
So we cut them out because we were not understanding the crop. Until I got knowledge that I had to do it this way for it to be able to fruit.
Mm.
And now I know. However, also cutting them away gave me space to put some other fruit trees. Now we have apples.
Oh, this is an apple.
Yeah, we have apples here. We're going to have pixie oranges and other fruits that work well with
strawberries
to fulfill our planned, you know, our planned activity.
Okay.
So these are mulberries. You can see they're yeah. all the way from here. All these are mulberries. They are now just beginning to set.
Mm.
We'll be bigger. We're going to also give them some manure,
mm.
goat dropping, which we shall put there, and we believe that the plant will suck it in and swell on the fruit.
What color will it be when it's ripe?
Black purple-ish.
Oh.
Purplish. Towards black.
Okay.
That's when it is sweetest.
Oh.
That's when it is readiest.
Mm. Okay.
Yeah.
That is an apple?
Yes. This is an apple tree.
How does it fare in this condition?
We are trying them out. I'm surprised. Like,
which apple is this? The variety?
I do not know. I am sorry to that answer. But I really don't know. But I know it's the red one.
Oh.
I don't know its name because I got it from an apple farmer who I unfortunately forgot to ask. But I also want to put in some green ones.
Mm.
And then we are bringing in some other fruits there. Pixie oranges, guavas. We're also bringing in like dragon fruit,
mm.
again in preparation of our future stuff. So we have the apples,
mm.
we have blackberries down there, there's a line down there of blackberries, and then raspberries, which mm. we're not doing so well, but we're bringing in another seedling,
mm.
Thanks to Mrs. Madivani,
mm.
who visited me, and we did an exchange. I gave her strawberries, and she's giving me raspberries,
mm.
and then we shall also have some other fruit trees. Just for people to have a better experience
mm.
when they come here.
Mm. How important is networking when it comes to farming? Because now I've heard you've met Mrs. Madivani, that is not a small name,
mm.
and you're doing exchanges, mm. so it seems like networking is a key thing. How
paramount.
Mm-hmm.
It is paramount. It's, mm. it's today for you want to survive in mm. whatever field you are.
Mm.
I think everyone needs a certain type of networking or something that we call a social capital.
Right.
Because, you know, you can pull strings here and there. They don't have to be political, but you can get, you know, better services and better experiences by just knowing Jackie.
Okay. And even the market.
Can you imagine you guys?
Yes, so that is it. And I think it's very important. God has blessed me with good people.
And I'm very grateful for what I have. People just come here and we're able to do irrigation systems, we're able to try out certain things with engineers. I'm working with schools to develop technological things. I'm working with St. Mary's Chisubi. I'm working with Gaza Farm Camp. We're using this as a class area to do, you know, subjects like physics, chemistry. How does the biology fit here? How does mathematics, how does the new curriculum really fit into a garden like this? And I'm so very, you know, honored to be part of a journey like that.
Well, that has been a great discussion with Rebecca Azar Senkubuge, a strawberry farmer based in Entebbe. And from that discussion, what I have understood is that the consumption of strawberries is actually growing, and more so in Uganda. And it indicates, a rise in demand for strawberries in the country. And lucky enough for us, our environment actually is suitable for strawberry growing in this country. So all you need to do, from what I gather from Rebecca's submission, is that you need just to have your space, then, you know, set up your garden, have enough water for your strawberries, and then look out for things like millipedes and then the snails. Those are your biggest enemies in the world of strawberry, you know, farming. So those shouldn't be there, but you just have enough water and, you know, your strawberries will be growing, you know, beautifully and organically. The emphasis is on organic farming of strawberries, because that is what is going to sell for you, not just here in Uganda, but also in the global market if you choose to venture. So if you're wondering why grow up strawberries, it is the time to now venture into it in your small space at home. You can actually grow your strawberries. You can have a few plants and then, you know, grow the numbers of plants until you can harvest much more. And she actually mentions that from about 10 strawberries put in a pack, she can actually get 12,000 per pack. So you can do your math, 12,000 per pack. Imagine you've picked like 100 strawberries in a day. That will be how much. That is some good money for you, you know, to just make from your small space at home. So that has been the Harvest Money Show. I have been your host, Jackie Chan. Until next